Joy. welcome to the All Saints Cathedral online service. Before we begin the service, we just want to thank you, and we are glad that you are joining us this morning to worship the Lord together. Now, if you're new to us, do connect with us through social media. And now with that, let us worship the Lord. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, good morning and welcome to the All Saints Cathedral online worship service. The Lord be with you. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the Almighty Saviour. God is Spirit. We must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord now and forever. Amen. Let us say the collect for purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Kyries. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Hallelujah! A blessed, wonderful morning to everyone. Hallelujah. It's always a pleasure to come together and worship our Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit of God. We're longing for your presence in the heart of your people. We seek you, Holy Spirit. give my all for you alone. Pour out your spirit, move in your power. Jesus, you are all.
Let us say the collect for the third Sunday of Advent prayerfully. Almighty God, who sent your servant John the Baptist to prepare your people for the coming of your Son, inspire the ministers and stewards of your truth to turn our disobedient hearts to the law of love, that when he comes again in glory, we may stand with confidence before him as our judge, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is taken from the book of Thessalonians, chapter 5, verses 1 to 28. 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5, beginning to read from verse 1. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying, peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit, do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good, reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you true and true. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Brothers and sisters, pray for us. Greet all God's people with a holy kiss. I charge you before the Lord to have this letter read to all brothers and sisters. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John, chapter 1, beginning at verse 6 to 8, and from 19 to 28. Glory to you, Lord Jesus. John chapter 1, verse 6. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Verse 19. Now this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees, who had been sent, questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Shalom and good morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Again, it is a privilege for us to meet you in the air and even to worship together with you wherever you are. Today is the final part of our series, Two Comings, and the title of our preaching today is Living in Between, taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 to 28. Let us pray. Father, we thank you again for giving us the privilege of coming to you, in worshiping you, rededicating our life again wherever we are. We pray that even as we listen to your word, the Holy Spirit that inspired the word of God right from the beginning is the Spirit of God who will inspire and enlighten our hearts to understand the things that God wants us to understand today. Help your servant as I share your word to your people, that will continue to inspire your servant and even to speak the language of the hearts of your people, so that as you continue to share your word, you will continue to be glorified for your own glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, First Thessalonians was written to a Christian community, but at the same time, that Christian community were living in the community where they thought about the second coming of Jesus Christ, whether seriously or not seriously. There were two attitudes, or extreme attitudes, that people were following and doing and practicing. The first one, of course, says that Jesus is coming very soon. And as a result, they said, "We don't have to work. We don't have to do anything. We just wait for his coming." But the other extreme groups thought that the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ is still a long way to go. He probably is not coming. And therefore, we just live as we like. We just do the things according to what we want. And we only need to repent nearer the time. This kind of thinking became a challenge to the Christian community as well as the leadership of the church. Because it takes a person to understand what actually God wants to do. But at the same time, our God is so great that no one could understand Him fully according to what we can think of. The fact is that no one knows when God, the Lord Jesus Christ's second coming is. And as a result, the First Thessalonians was written as an important guide and instructions to deal with the challenge, not just superficially, but to get to the root of the whole problem, and that was a spiritual problem that the Thessalonians congregation was facing. Just to recap what we have been hearing and hopefully learning in the past 4 weeks. My first point is we live and you live. The First Thessalonians chapter 1, live for God. In order just to wait and expect Jesus Christ to come for the second time as a judge and greatest judge of all, Paul advised the Thessalonians to just live for God. Of course, in the second chapter, there is a need to continue to live in a way that would honor God, because as a Christians, as the follower of Christ, we are, and they were, the Thessalonians were the product of God Himself, and therefore we need to live lives worthy of God Himself. The third chapter talks about the need to live to love others. Now, Greek root word parousio, which implies something that overflows or spills over the top, speaks about love, not just loving amongst us, not just love certain groups that familiar to us, but it talks about love to the next level, that we need to love others even beyond boundaries, beyond what we can think of, beyond the groups that are familiar to us. And that is why, as we wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ, there is a necessity to love not just within the Christian community, but love those who are outside of the Christian's community. Of course, in chapter 4, it talks about encouraging one another. Now, the word encouraging one another is in the context of eternity. I remember the late Bishop Albert says, we are not living in the space of a few years. We are living in the space of eternity. And therefore, whatever we do as Christians, we need to think, we need to live, we need to practice, we need to view everything in the light of eternity, and even to encourage one another, as probably some have lost the life of the loved ones and they feel that there is no hope to meet them again, so much so that life probably come to an end at any time. There is a need to encourage one another that we are living in the space of eternity. And therefore, we need to encourage one another in chapter 4. But of course, in chapter 5, as we learn together today, there is an encouragement for us to live, be blameless in order to welcome the Lord Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters in Christ, of course, it is important for us to live according to the word of God, is wait for the coming of Jesus Christ. But again, when it comes to chapter 5, basically there are two sections of chapter 5. The first one, of course, is talking about what do you know? What is your positions? What actually is your spiritual life is? And how to wait? How to come to certain maturity as a wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ? And secondly, of course, there will be some kind of encouragement to do some practical things in life as a wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ. I can simplify what Paul says in chapter 5, verses 1 to 11 by saying, we know, you know. We know what you know. We have the confidence that you know something, not just about the Lord Jesus Christ, but knowing Him personally, and therefore it influences your life as we ought to, as we think of Jesus Christ, as we dedicate our lives to Jesus Christ. That dedication, that thinking, that commitment will influence the way we live. And therefore, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 to 11, at least there are four things that the Christians in Thessalonians should know and have been in the known for so many years. The first one, Paul says, you know his coming. You should know about his coming. His coming is like a thief in verse 1 to verse 3. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and deaths, we do not need to write to you. You know already. You know very well. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destructions will come on them suddenly as labor pains in the pregnant woman, and they will not escape. No wonder Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, verse 36, but about the day or hour no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. In verse 42, Jesus said, therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day our Lord will come. Many people can predict something. Even the weather, people can predict. Even the economy, people can predict. But no one knows the second coming of Jesus, because it is like the coming of the thief at night. But the Thessalonian church, that congregations, they knew about the coming, the nature of his coming. And Paul says, you know his coming. We know what you know about his coming. Of course, secondly, Paul says, you know who you are. You know your positions in Christ Jesus. You are the children of light. Verse 4, but you, brothers and sisters, you are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. I do believe that the whole thinking went back to the word of Jesus in John chapter 8, verse 12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we follow, as we obey, as we trust and put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, accepting Him as our Lord, personal Lord and Savior, we are not living in darkness, because Jesus is the light of the world, the light of our life. And therefore, his coming should not be a surprise to us. His second coming, probably even if it is all of a sudden, he comes. But it should not be a surprise to all of us, because it's the children of the light. As the follower of the light of the world, and that is Jesus Christ himself, we should understand that we are in the positions of knowing and understand God's will, as far as the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ is concerned. But again, Paul says in verse 6 to 8, you know what to do. It is because you are the children of the light. It is because you know who you are, even the nature of the second coming of Jesus Christ, and then therefore you should know what to do. In verse 6, so then let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. The love as a breastplate, that to me protects the heart. And of course, hope of salvation is a helmet. Salvation that protects the mind. There is always a challenge for our mind, especially the modern world, about our salvation. Just think about what one of the MP said in the parliament about our Bible. There is always a challenge. What about the young generations? I think they are more exposed to all these challenges wherever they are. Especially when you talk about intellectual capacity. If you can't go against your heart, they will attack your mind. And therefore, it is important for us to be awake, to be careful, to be extra careful and sober all the time. Because in no time, the evil one may come and attack not just our hearts, but even our mind. So Paul says to the Thessalonians, you know what to do. Of course, in verses 9 to 11, Paul says, you know the outcome. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation from our Lord Jesus Christ. The eternal salvation in Jesus Christ is the ultimate aim for eternity. Verse 10, he died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. The kingdom of God, the membership in the kingdom of God, is the only membership that cannot be stopped through death. Because with the life live in the world, or after our life in this world, we are still the members of that kingdom of God. So brothers and sisters in Christ, that is why it's very important for us to know and to be convinced about eternity. Once we don't believe in eternity, then whatever belief, whatever religions, whatever things that you want to say about eternity, it is probably all in vain. But when we believe that there is life after death, you know, in life, life is so uncertain. Even the young ones, a few months, a few weeks. Recently, we've heard of a child of the great footballer of Malaysia, only 22 days, involved in accident and passed away. It's not a matter of age. Life is so unpredictable and uncertain. But death is certain. Everyone will experience it, no matter how great, how long, how old the person is. Everyone. Life is certain. But there is another dimension that we need to know. That life after death is certain only in Jesus Christ, who says, I'm the way, the truth, and life. He is not someone who show life, show the truth. He is life. And brothers and sisters in Christ, and therefore, we need to encourage one another. As verse 11 says, therefore encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Brothers, Paul says, you know he's coming. You know who you are. You know what to do. And you know the outcome. But there is another part in chapter 5 of 1 Thessalonians, and that is the practical encouragement. As I call it, we encourage, we pray. There is a need to encourage one another. Sometimes it is very difficult to get encouragement. Most of the time we receive, when we hear, we see around us things that is not so encouraging. But that is one of the needs of many today. In verses 12 and 13, there is a need for Paul says, we ask, in order for us to encourage and receive encouragement, we ask. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with one each other. It is important for us to be convinced of the need to acknowledge our brothers and sisters who are working hard amongst us. I read one of the commentators says, it is good and important holding church leadership in high regard, including all who share leadership responsibilities in the church. It is not just so-called the full-time workers. It is everyone who are involved in the ministry, in the children ministry, in the youth ministry, even young adults ministry, among the senior citizens. They may not be a full-time worker, but they are the people that God has placed, God has called them, and the church acknowledge and recognize them in the leadership. They too must be acknowledged for the works that they are doing for the Lord. I think we need to stop comparing, which leads to unhealthy competitions or strife. Because when we compare with one another, when you compare yourselves to other people, you lose your value. You are who you are. And the Lord made you, created you as you are. And God must have something great in you that he is proud about. And therefore, no need to compare. You know, sometimes people are comparing this speaker, this pastor, that branded pastor, and so on. But the Bible says we need to acknowledge, we need to encourage those who work hard, those who care, those who admonish you. This is not just for the full-time worker. It is for everyone in the leadership, in the ministry, who serves together as a team, whoever they are. They may be working behind the scene, but brothers and sisters, they need to be acknowledged. The question is this: when was the last time that you acknowledge and reaffirm your leaders? Or did you compare your leaders with someone else and begin to criticize instead of giving encouragement? The Bible says we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, those who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Of course, there is also need for us to look at verses 14 to 22. We urge you, not just we ask you, but we urge you. And we urge you, verse 14, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. I always say to my staff, my fellow servants in the cathedral, ministry is 24 hours, not office hours. Because we need to cultivate that kind of discipline. The life that you've given to God is 24 hours. It's not just for certain hours of the day then I will serve. No. Ministry is 24 hours, not office hours. We are grateful that the church members doesn't leave the work of ministering entirely to the spiritual leaders, but accept several responsibilities together as the members of the body of Christ. I think that is important. We need to acknowledge one another. Once our life is surrendered to God, whatever positions we are holding in the society, we belong to God. And therefore, our ministry that God has placed upon us, that God has called us, is 24 hours. Every day, every moment of our life. And therefore, this Paul charged them with the responsibility to warn those loafers about their slothful attitude. They could be belong to the group that think Jesus is not coming soon. So they just want to enjoy life, relaxing, and they want to repent nearer the time. And Paul says, no, warn this group who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened. Brothers and sisters in Christ, in verse 16, there is 16, 17, 18, and of course 19 up to 20, 22. There is a positive and a negative side of what he is trying to say. Some of the practical things, practical advice. Verse 16 says, rejoice always. Pray continually. Verse 18, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Brothers, we can only give thanks to God, rejoice in Him If our heart is forever grateful for the things of God and for what God has done in our life. If we are not convinced of what God has been doing in our life, it is very difficult to just rejoice in Him and give thanks. Unless we are forever grateful for what God has been doing in our life, in our hearts, it is very difficult to rejoice and even to pray. No wonder Paul says, rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks. Verse 19, do not quench the spirit, do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. Brothers, the true work of the Holy Spirit is building His church, building the faith of God's people. But if we resist the work of the Holy Spirit, then it will lead us to what the Bible says, lukewarm attitude. And as a result, we may lose the rewards from the Lord. So it is important for us to be open to what the Spirit of God is doing. We should not be influenced by what other people say. We should be looking to what the Bible says about the Holy Spirit. And let the Spirit of God convict our hearts of the things of God that He wants us to know more and more. And of course, Paul says in verses 23 to 24, we pray for you, we pray with you. May God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. Listen to this, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, souls, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful. He will do it. A scholar says, the Spirit connects us to God and enables us to worship God and to fellowship with Him. The soul is the seat of emotions and makes us conscious of our being. The body connects us to our environment. And according to this scholar, we need to be kept faultless by God in our worship of Him, in our fellowship with Him. We need to be free of any legitimate accusations in our inner being and in our social relationship. Being sanctified by God Himself. It's not just one part of our being. Spirit, soul, and our body. That is why when we worship God, it is not just worshiping with the movement of our body or even the emotions that we have for the Lord. But it's more importantly to have that connection in the Spirit with the Spirit of God, our Spirit and the Spirit of God being connected. So that as we continue to have this connection in the Spirit, that we know that we are belong to Him. Lastly, of course, verse 25, 26, 27, and 28. After giving the practical advice, Paul said a prayer or wrote the prayer for this church. He said, brothers and sisters, pray for us. Isn't it encouraging that a spiritual father like Paul himself, no matter how great, how important he is in the kingdom of God, he still acknowledged the need for the church to pray for him, because there is always the weaknesses. There's always something that is lacking that we need the help of everyone, especially God's people who knows what to pray for their leaders. And Paul says, pray for us. That reminds me of King David. When he said, I was glad when he said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Even as a man of God, the worship leader, the musicians, and even someone whose heart is so close to God himself. He needs encouragement of someone else when he said, I was glad when someone else was said to me, not just me saying to someone else, let us go to the house of the Lord, but others will say to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. As much as David needs encouragement from others, Paul says, pray for us. As much as he can pray for all the churches, that especially the churches, the congregations that he founded in his missionary journeys, he still says, pray for us. Brothers, and in verse 26, greet all God's people with a holy kiss. That's something to do with their culture, but at the same time, it's something to do with their intimate relationship as God's people, as the children of God together. But verse 27, there is a request. I charge you before the Lord to have this letter read to all the brothers and sisters. And after saying all this, Paul in verse 28 says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. That grace is important. The grace for salvation. The grace to stay safe and endure the trials and the Christian life they need to go through while waiting for the second coming of Jesus. But that grace will lead us home to be with the Lord forever. So in conclusion, the Lord Jesus Christ is certainly coming again. 1 year is gone. Every time you celebrate your birthday, you are 1 year closer to the second coming of Jesus. 1 month is gone, when probably you receive your paycheck. You're 1 month closer to the second coming of Jesus Christ. 1 week is gone, when probably you go to the church. We all are 1 week closer to the second coming of Jesus. 1 day is gone. No matter how important it is, it could be your day. But 1 day is gone. We are 1 day closer to the second coming of Jesus. But remember this. With each passing moment in your life, it's gone. We are actually 1 moment closer to the second coming of Jesus. So remember this. 1 moment is gone. We are 1 moment closer to the second coming of Jesus Christ. Christmas is just around the corner. When we remember the first coming of Jesus into the world. But Christmas is also a reminder to us about his second coming. Are you ready for his second coming? If you are not ready, or even if you are ready, we have the message for you for this coming Christmas. Fear not. And that new series will begin next Sunday. Fear not. See you next Sunday. Fear not. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for giving us the word. And thank you for the Holy Spirit that always reminding us of the truth of your word. Help us to be always open to you and to be alert of your second coming. Each moment of our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, we thank God for his message to us. And now, let us reaffirm our faith by saying the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, let us now all unite our hearts together for intercessory prayer. O Heavenly Father, how we love to praise and exalt your holy name. O heaven and earth, shout hallelujah to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. May your mighty name resonate throughout the whole earth. May your kingdom come. And may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord God, we give thanks for the 31st Diocesan Synod meeting, which was held last week from the 4th to the 5th of December. Our diocesan theme for the next 2 years will be Year of Reaping 2020-2022. As our Diocese of Sabah moves forward to sow and reap with challenges ahead, we want to uphold Archbishop Melter and his leadership in prayers. Protect and guide him as he endeavors to fulfill his calling. Grant him strength, patience, and wisdom to envisage where the Holy Spirit leads him to. Open up doors to the advancement of the kingdom of God in the lives of many. As we sow in faith, may God direct us to the harvest of plenty in his time. Lord God, we thank you for guiding us through the preparation works for the English Congregation Christmas Celebration 2020, which will premiere on the 20th of December. We rejoice as different ministry groups are contributing to the whole program for that night. Through their concerted efforts and dedication, and most of all, Lord God, through your blessings and inspiration, it has given us the hope to bring the joy of Christmas into the homes of many in this season. May this celebration night reveal the love, joy, and peace of Christ in the audience's hearts. Lord God, we commit the COVID-19 pandemic situation in Malaysia to you. as our nation experiences the roller coaster effect of infected cases and seeing no end to it yet, we earnestly plead for your grace and mercy to heal our land and restore us to fullness. Though we see more economic activities and places of worship opening up and more people moving about, the presence of the virus is still prevalent among us. Teach us to be vigilant and to be watchful at all times, seeking and looking up to you in all things in prayerful manner. Gracious and merciful God, to whom we bring our prayers unto thee, grant that you will bring them to pass through the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Lord, have mercy upon us and write these laws in our hearts, we beseech you. The Confession. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us therefore confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all men. Together. Merciful God, our Heavenly Father, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men, in thought, word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We repent and are truly sorry for our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you and deliver you from all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you for his service by the power of the Holy Spirit and keep you in eternal life. Amen. Now that we've been right with God through faith in Jesus Christ, we have peace with God. So, we must make peace with one another in the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Brothers and sisters in Christ, lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is not only right, it is our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And now we give you thanks, because the day of our deliverance is dawn, and through him you will make all things new, as he comes with power and triumph to judge the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Let us pray. All glory to you, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for redemption. He made therefore atonement for the sins of the whole world, offering once for all his one sacrifice of himself. He instituted in his holy gospel, commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray, and granted by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive these gifts of bread and wine, according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, Holy Institution, in remembrance of his death and suffering, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Amen. Together we say, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Blessed are those who are invited to the feast of the Lamb.
Let us rejoice and give glory to God.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Draw you with faith and humbly receive this bread and wine, in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. And now you can distribute the elements of the Holy Communion to your family members, those who are confirmed.
Strong.
Let us pray as our Savior taught us together. O Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the time of trial, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thanksgiving prayer together. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you that you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.